All right, so I'm getting ready to start this whole painting unit thing. And with anything involving paint, you are gonna wanna do your drawings first. That way you've got everything kind of mapped out, all that. So I've got each one of these labeled. I'm gonna run through these pretty fast, but some of these I have listed, a couple of them I don't yet. But these are just some of my favorite elementary school projects for painting. Excuse me. Wayne Thiebaud is an artist that I like to talk about a lot when it comes to American pop art. He did a lot of confections paintings like cakes, lollipops, bubblegum, that kind of thing. It's a really handy way to begin teaching dimensional drawing and to talk about taking like a circle and transform it into an oval and then turn it into a cylinder and then start actually making things that look like dimensional cakes. Another thing that kind of helps out with the bubblegum project is to give your kids different size templates. So you can do this with younger kids for sure. The lollipop project is all about understanding ellipses, so there's a lot of mathematics involved with this, but it also deals with perspective as well. This one is a fun one, about first, second grade, so this one's all about outer space and kind of has a lot to do with science, that kind of thing, atmospheres, astronomy, you know, so like doing a planetary study would work really well. I call it intergalactic planetary. And then kind of sports themed one. So I always call it a game of pool, soccer, tennis ball, anything, or baseball, anything that is oriented with the shape of a ball, as it were. And then I have a couple of traditional projects that we're going to talk about here as well. But for the cake Thiebaud project, what I'm first going to do is I am going to And I know what this piece looks like, but usually I'll give kids like an example first so that they can kind of look off of that. And we talk about equilateral design. So usually what I'll do is I'll have them divide this into four areas. And then I ask them to think of different ways that we can incorporate different types of cakes in here. I'll have them practice drawing circles. Usually when I have my students draw circles, I'll have them just hold the pencil way back by the end like this. And then I'll just have them repeat something like this over and over. And the goal is to try to make one circle if they can. Nobody's totally capable of making a singular circle. And what I do is I have them take a dot here and a dot here. And then to make the oval, you want to practice basically connecting those dots like this. And a lot of times you end up with kind of a hot dog type shape or a corn dog or something like that. So to make that a little bit better, we can add more dots. So dots that force us to pull out a little bit more like this. So that's a good way to create a good oval. And so when you feel like your students have had a little bit of practice with that, then you'll have them pick one of these little quadrants where they will create a long shape here and a skinnier shape here. Then you're gonna have them just practice by going in circles, rather ovals. Next up, we probably wanna use a straight edge. I'm gonna be moving pretty quickly here for the sake of getting this done in a timely manner. And I'm just sketching lightly, okay? Don't see me doing anything crazy heavy on here. I wanna be able to erase stuff if I'm incorrect with it. Now what we need here is a parallel to this, okay? So we need something that mimics this. Sometimes with younger kids, again, I'll cut these out of die cuts, or I'll find templates for them, but they can start to learn how to draw these things over time. An easy way for them to create a good parallel, and this is again a mathematics thing, is to actually measure down. So I'm gonna measure down, let's see, an inch and a half from my dot there. And then I'm gonna measure down an inch and a half from my dot here. Now I'm gonna come down here and measure an inch and a half from my dot here. Now if I take these and I connect them like this as best I can, I should have a parallel. So I should have a nice kind of cylinder looking thing that I can work with. Okay, let's do just a single piece of cake by itself, maybe over here, right? So for this one, we're going to start with something a little bigger. So what I'm going to do this time is I'm going to connect those dots like that. Then what I'm going to do is I'm going to come over here connect these two dots right here. That's going to be like the cake's kind of cut in half kind of thing. Then I'm just going to go at a weird angle from here, whatever I think I want. Now I'm going to go an inch and a half down like I did before. Go an inch and a half down over here too. I don't need to go an inch and a half down there. Okay, let's see. I think we should make this cake look like it's been like cut apart. I know that I want this to be one big piece. So I think what I'm gonna do is maybe come out here and just take another notch out of it like that. Let's go straight down with that at an inch and a half. Yeah, I like that pretty well. Now I just need a parallel to this one. So to do that, I just line it up and I drag it over here. Call that good. Now I need a parallel to this one. I'm gonna drag that over there and get a good parallel. Boom. Now I need a parallel to this one. Boom. Never too early to start teaching perspective for kiddos. So I've got a pretty good looking thing going on here. What I'm gonna do now, let's see. I don't want to do this other piece of cake. I think I want to make it look like it's, yeah, let's do this. Let's get this one to kind of come back a little bit this way. It's going to look weird if I do it, but let's try it anyway. Never know until you try something, right? Yeah, like somebody ate Marston piece of cake, but was like being polite and didn't want to have to finish it off. My family does that. I'm always the one that finishes it though. So we got to get a parallel to that one. So we're going to come down here like this. And I'm going to go ahead and just come over and get a straight line here. Okay. A couple of pieces of cake there. Now just to balance things out, I'm going to do this again over here. And again, I'm going to do this quicker now that you've seen the way that I do it. I usually draw like I'm drawing like in an x-ray way. There we go. And I think over here, I'm just gonna go with one singular slice that's maybe a little more hefty. Kind of making me hungry here. Like a piece of pie, really. Okay, I'm done with that. So like, I like double-decker cake. So I like to talk to the students about like, you're making your own cake, you know? Like, how do you want this to be? Do we want cherries on top of that, you know? Do we want to get some double-decker action in here? Yeah. I think in this one, I'm just gonna make it look like it's been cut, just cut, like straight cut. It's ready to go. Maybe it's a birthday cake. I'm just like taking slices from the middle here. I'm gonna go straight down on the side like that. And maybe I'll put some candles on there. Maybe this dude's turning like, I don't know. How old is this person gonna be today? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 7 was a magical year. Okay, last cake. what do we do? Ooh, I think my favorite kind of cake, though, is bundt cake. So I'm going to put a little circle in here. And I love all the ribs that come out from that. So I'm just going to, like, draw some ribs that come out from that. So, like, once you have that whole cylindrical shape, you can, like, start transforming it into all kinds of different shapes. Whatever you can imagine that would have that basic kind of shape scenario. And I'm just gonna like scallop the bottom. Whenever my wife asks me what kind of cake I want for my birthday, it's always gotta be the bundt cake with a cherry drizzle frosting. Oh, in fact, I'm gonna go ahead and drop some frosting all over this thing. Kind of looks like a pumpkin. Cool. All right, so we need to get some plates on this thing. So I'm gonna go ahead and just get like another oval down here. So you can see how this is good for helping students with geometry, understanding ovals, ellipses, how to transform a circle to an ellipse, how to get better with drawing basic shapes, and how to study some art history while you're doing it. Okay, so my cake T-bod project's done. All right, next up, let's jump into intergalactic planetary. Okay, so this one's all about, this one is all about size difference. So I made a whole bunch of little templates here. Typically, things that are smaller are further away from us. And typically, things that are going to be like further up on the picture plane are going to be further away from us too. But when we're looking at like a picture of space or something like that, you know, the order of where it's at vertically, which is called vertical perspective, is not necessarily something that happens all the time. You could have massive planets up here, same down here, and you could have overlapping of like a big planet and a small planet. It happens a lot. So with this kind of a thing, really what we're looking for is overlapping, but we're also looking for shadows, and we're looking for just kind of a good imaginative way of working with a solar system type scenario. So what I would do is I would probably like have the kids think about some planets, maybe even like throw some extra like invented planets up in there. So I just took a whole bunch of things, traced around and cut them. I think I'm gonna start up over here somewhere. I'm gonna trace one of these guys. A good looking one. I'm gonna get one off the page. It's always a good idea compositionally to get something going off the page, because nothing's perfectly stuck within the confines of a border, something like that. It just doesn't work. I did keep some of these. Sometimes I do that, and what that does is that helps the students with this idea that they don't have to just use the interior portion or the exterior portion of the stencil. They can use the exterior as well. Get some like smaller planets that are kind of going back in the space here. Okay. I think I want something really big too. What else do we have here that could work? Yeah, I used that one before. Okay, so maybe what I'll do then, I'm kind of liking the flow that's happening here. Maybe I'll drop this one down in here. And this could be a good place for an overlap. Maybe a cluster of little moons or something. Like, I think I'm gonna drop this one over the top. Kind of looks like an eyeball. It's kind of cool. And maybe like a smaller planet kind of moving around to the back. And maybe, just because I don't have anything quite big enough for that. Really like that kind of flow happening there. And then we'll drop one more big planet next to that. And maybe a star of some kind. So I think for that, I'm just gonna give myself something that looks like a sunburst kind of, right? And maybe another planet coming into view. Okay. Let's see, I like the whole idea of using the ovals again. So I'm gonna drop an oval around this one. Now, of course, it doesn't look like it's around, right? Looks like it's through, but the reason I draw it over it is so it looks correct as it comes back. A lot of times when people are drawing these kind of things, they'll end up with something like this, and then they draw like this. That looks way less natural than that does. So, I'll go ahead and use what I have there. And then as it goes behind the planet, obviously that overlapping element is what helps give us that space. And I feel like any good painting is gonna have some indication of space. Should look like we can like walk into that thing. Okay, cool, I got my drawing down for that one. Okay. Let's talk bubblegum real quick. Usually for the bubblegum project, I'll have my students develop like a bubblegum machine, right? So something really big like this. This is more like kindergarten, first grade. And then, you know, maybe instead of having them control their paintbrush into the inside of this, you give them like stamps to where they can stamp different colors. You can cut potatoes and have them ink those up. But more or less, this is about pattern. It's about variety. It's about using your primary and secondary colors. So these are all different smatterings of ages. You want to pick something at your ability level, but also pick something that you think you might want to create an example for when you start teaching. So when I do this with the students, I usually have them really get close and work them up right next to another so that we have all these little non-gumball spaces that can be kind of filled with other textures and things. And you can see how a drawing like this might take me a while, so I'm probably not going to finish demonstrating. Usually, when I do have the students do this, once they get to this point, what I'll have them do is go in there and just try to fill these little guys up with little circles. Like I try to have them think about like nerds, you know, or like candy that's very small, right? So I'm gonna go ahead and finish this one out later in the interest of getting these other ones drawn. So the lollipop project, T-Bud did a lot of lollipops. And again, working with something that's a flat circle, we need to get that to look more dimensional. So we have to turn it into an oval. So for some older kids, you can have them draw their oval. For younger kids, you can go ahead and have them, you can have them, you know, work from a template. Sometimes what I'll have my students do though, just for variety's sake, is I'll have them trace out, this one's bigger, it's good for him. I'll have them trace out like a flat one. I'll have them make one flat lollipop so that they can see basically what the difference is between a flat lollipop and one that isn't flat. So it's four, this is a 4-inch. And so I'm trying to find that area where it's thickest like this. And that's gonna help me denote kind of where the middle of the piece is. Looks like it's just a little thicker right there. So now I can go ahead and try to find my 4 inches this way. Looks like it gets wider or skinnier. It's wider right there. That's gonna get a little spot for me there. Just eyeball in the middle roughly. That's pretty good. Okay, so now I'm just gonna go ahead and add my stick to either side like this. And again, I'm gonna draw it very flat just to kind of help illustrate and show the students what it looks like when you draw and paint something that's very flat versus something that's not very flat. So having them find the middle is helpful because usually when you have a lollipop, you're going to have them try to keep a good consistent spiral. Again, really good for pencil control. Okay, so what I'm gonna do on these other ones is I'm gonna go ahead and make my dots. Come down a little bit there. I think for this one, I'm going to try to make it a little bit bigger and have it go off to the side a little bit. Samesies here. Get my oval going on inside of that. Okay, so if we're looking at this flat on, it's kind of like looking at a quarter flat on. You're not really going to see the edge very much, but as we start to turn it, we will see the edge. It's just like this tape, right? We're going to see this, and once we start moving it, then we get to see this side. So with this, we don't really see this side, but with these, we do. And so what that means is on these extreme edges, we need a straight line down. Then we need to probably crisp up this line. So I'm just gonna take my pencil back over it, make it heavier. I'm just just gonna go ahead and finish this out since I'm working on this anyway. That could be a little better, but in the interest of brevity, I'm gonna continue. Yep. Go back around this way. Man, my chair is so squeaky today. Okay, so now we're gonna use this hole. Like, we had these marks here. This is what we're gonna use to find the center. It's kind of a handy thing for us, because now what we can do is we can say, okay, we know this is about the middle. That's about where that would come out of. And so what we'll do is we'll make a small oval there. Usually, the stick goes in for a little bit. And so what I do is I kind of draw lightly inside of there like that. And I draw it just a little skinnier as it goes in. Okay, so when you're looking at a straw face on, it's gonna be straight like that. But when you're looking at one end on, it's going to be wider on the end you're looking in. And it's going to get skinnier as it goes away. It's just an illusion, but that's essentially what we're doing here with this, okay? And now what we do is we take that angle and we kind of like sketch it out lightly. It needs to get a little bigger as it comes toward us. If it gets too big and looks really weird, then we'll cut it down. But right now we're just gonna eyeball this. And that's why I'm sketching so lightly, because, you know, like, I want to erase it, fix it if I think I need to. Okay, so then I'm going to come out what I would feel like is a reasonable amount, and then again, another oval, right? And then this time, I'm going to finish off my stick from my lollipop. That stick's a little bit long, but I'm kind of exaggerating it to show the dimension. So now I've got a couple of dimensional ones and a not dimensional one. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to go ahead and get myself an oval once again. But my oval is going to warp and change a little bit. It's going to get bigger as it comes closer, and it's going to get smaller as it goes further away from me. It's kind of a weird thing. You might try drawing a like light and then go back over it. Okay, cool with that one. Nexties, a game of pool, soccer, tennis, baseball, whatever. Okay, so this is all about size difference, okay? So usually when you're working, like, I love to play pool, I'm a billiards guy, but usually when you're playing something with a ball of some kind, you're gonna have the same size ball, right? It's not gonna have a bunch of different sized balls. And so having all the same size ball means that as it gets deeper into space, they're going to appear smaller. So if I am playing, pool, and I've got all of these out here, right? And like, let's say I'm solids, okay? And I've got one down here that's a solid and I need to get in here. My cue ball is gonna look bigger than this ball, even though they're the same size, right? If I have one up over here, it might even look a lot bigger, right? Because it's going to be even closer to that than that one. This in here is going to be about medium size. You're going to have something way back here. It's going to be even smaller. The deeper the field, the smaller these appear, right? Also, if it's on a field like this, we want it to converge. Even though we know if we look down from it, it's going to look like a rectangle, right? But as we start to look more foreshortened on that, it's going to change more like this. More like this, till finally we're level with it. We don't see much of the top at all. So with this, you wanna set up whatever kind of a field it is that you're gonna be working with, right? So let's say for the sake of getting this thing done, yeah, I do wanna make this like a game of pool. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna kind of limit my field of view a little bit to maybe a corner. That way I'm not drawing the whole thing, right? So I've got a good corner here. Because this is a manufactured object, there are gonna be some straight edges to it. But by and large, I'm using my imagination, kind of thinking a little bit about like what I know it looks like. And I know the edge rounds off here. This is going to be the same because we're level with it. This is going to get bigger as it comes toward us because we're foreshortened with it. So it needs to be more like that. You might actually see some of this pocket here. So I'm going to go ahead and cut a little bit of that out of there. Now we are going to see some of this wall. So I'm bringing a line down there. I'm bringing this closer to the viewer, making it bigger. We're gonna go ahead and cut that off. Okay. And we'll see that as well. That's probably why that edge looks weird. Let's go ahead and cut across there and cut across here. That works. And then make that nice and dark. Okay, so let's see. Let's go with a pretty good size ball here, right? And we need something smaller as we go back. So we're probably gonna need something more like this. And I didn't have a template quite that big, so just how it's gonna have to be today. Now I need something probably relative to the size of this. So that might be too big for what I'm wanting to do. So I'm thinking a quarter might be the biggest I can go. And let's just go ahead and throw like another one right in here. And then maybe just like right on the edge, right? Okay, so let's make some of these stripes. To make some of them stripes, what we wanna do is we wanna get a line that kind of curves over like that and a line that curves over like that. That'll give us something that we can actually paint. We'll do a one with that one. Let's make this one a solid. So that means that we just need like some kind of a number on it, right? We'll make this one a straight, but we'll have it coming our way this time. Maybe with the seven going that way. A little bit of the stripe going like that. Let's go with one more stripe going this way just to make it interesting. Make that one a lucky number 13. And then just to make it cool, we'll throw an 8-ball in there. I'm pretty sure there's like a little circle around that one. Pretty sure there's a little circle around that one too. Okay, so I've got a pretty good drawing going on here. Could be a lot cooler to add some stuff back in here, whatever, but I think I've got it for the sake of getting the demo going. Last three that I want to work with real quick. Are going to be like a landscape. I know a lot of people get into landscapes. Also a project that I like to call sunset, sunrise, shadow. So like working with a figure, but not having to actually paint the figure itself. So this one, actually, we don't necessarily want to draw out ahead of time. We want to do the sunset or sunrise wash and then let it dry completely. And then we'll draw over it. For the still life, drawing is huge. It's way important. We want to make sure that that's going on beforehand, definitely. However, the landscape, for something like this, it's a really good idea to work from a reference. Because if you don't have like a photograph, or not outside painting, it may be difficult for you to dream something up that looks... that looks like it's appropriate to what you're trying to do. Now, of course, choose something at your ability level. I don't feel like I really like anything in this magazine. I'm gonna have to do a little bit more digging. But I'm going to get into these things here shortly. So stay tuned for my time-lapse video and the sketching of this business.